Krishna Pristaya Bhutale Srimati Bhakti Vedanta Swami Dinamane Namaste Sarasati Devi Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavani Paschachadesatarine. So good evening to everyone. Thank you for coming this evening on a very wet evening, not very pleasant. So thank you for taking the time. This evening we want to present to you the study of the nectar of devotion. Nectar of devotion. One of Srila Prabhupada's texts, which was published in 1970, I think it was, in the very early stages of the Krishna consciousness movement, Srila Prabhupada had written this book, The Nectar of Devotion. And like the teachings of Lord Chaitanya, it's a summary study. Srimad Bhagavatam and Bhagavad Gita, they are translations of texts. But the Nectar of Devotion and the teachings of Lord Chaitanya were Prabhupada's summary studies. Nectar of Devotion is, of course, a summary study of the book called Bhakti Ras Amrita Sindhu. And teachings of Lord Chaitanya was based on the writings from the Chaitanya Charitamrita. So Nectar of Devotion, yeah, we have copies of the slides here we're going to give you. If you like, you can have it for reference. So Nectar of Devotion is one of the texts which we taught in Bhakti Shastri. Some years ago, when I was coming here, I taught Bhakti Shastri to the devotees. Bhakti Shastri is made up of the study of the Bhagavad Gita, the Sri Upanishad, the Nectar of Devotion, the Nectar of Instruction. And we don't teach the whole of the Nectar of Devotion, because the book goes into some detail. The book goes into some advanced topics in the study of rasa, or the different relationships between devotees. But we do cover the first section of the Nectar of Devotion. And what I want to do here, and this week, we're going to present some of the basic topics. You can see here what we're going to be covering. I have 4 evenings. We'll see how we get on. Hopefully we can finish these first 4 lessons. But there's a number of others which I'll cover another time when I come. So the first lesson, we're going to have a quick overview of this Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. Rupa Goswami gave the title Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu to this text. Now, Bhakti, of course, means devotion. Rasa, meaning the mellow or the juice. Rasa, it's not a word which we would use unless we were in this devotional line. We don't usually hear about ras very much. Well, ras, of course, we do. You think of juice, right? We want some ras. Give me some ras. Sweet juice, something very nectarian, right? So rasa also refers to the relationships, the dealings between people. There are certain rasas, just like with food. Some food has a rasa. It's very, it's very sweet. And some people are very fond of sweet. They enjoy that rasa. Other people may prefer the more bitter ras. So in the same way, in dealings with people, there's different rasas. There's different mellows or exchanges between one person and another. And this is the topic of the Nectar of Devotion. We're looking at the rasa between the Lord and his devotees. And also, there's rasa between devotees, also one devotee and another. We will have some kind of rasa. Srila Prabhupada explains how in the material world, everyone is driven on, the motivating force behind every activity is this rasa. You have some rasa for our family. You're a married man or woman, you have a family, then you have a particular affection for them. That rasa is natural. In the same way, there's also rasa for our country, nationalism. Someone's very nationalistic. Some people are very devoted to Singapore, right? And some other people may be from Malaysia, and someone else is from India. They're thinking more about their country, their origin. And so this is another kind of rasa. And some people are more devoted just simply to humanity. We want to help all mankind. And so these are different rasas which are there in the material world. But this book, Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, is describing a special rasa. Because while these rasas are there in the material world, these rasas are not eternal. Just like the family, we come together for some time, but then we are separated. You don't stay together forever, it's not eternal. And that, our country also, we take birth in one country, then you may go and live in another country. You know, the relationships of these kind of rasas is very temporary. But Rupa Goswami, the author of this book, Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, he's describing a special rasa, which is Amrita, Ras Amrita Sindhu. It's Amrita, meaning Amrit can mean either nectar or something which is eternal, which never ends. So both meanings are applicable in this case. And then Sindhu, it's not limited, it's an ocean. So the ocean of devotion, of the ocean of nectarian loving devotion, this is being described here. How is it possible to describe an ocean? Of course, you cannot describe everything about the ocean, just like we may go and swim in the ocean. We know a little bit about the ocean, but we don't know everything. The ocean is so vast. So in the same way, the ocean of devotional service is so vast, it's so unlimited. We cannot know everything about it. But in this book, Rupa Goswami is describing some few drops of this ocean of nectar. And from the nature of a few drops, we can understand more the nature of the ocean. By tasting the water in the sea, you know more about the ocean. You know, you taste the water in the sea salty. You know the whole ocean is going to be salty. So the same way we taste the nectar of devotion, we will know more about the whole ocean. Here you see Srila Rupa Goswami. Rupa Goswami, Srila Prabhupada describes him as being the leader of the Goswamis. We've written here, that Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, the Sanskrit word, we know, we have shortcut the translation, because the nectar of devotion. So Prabhupada, rather than describing it all, the full meaning of Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, he's simply given the title of his book, Nectar of Devotion. Rupa Goswami's purpose is to present the ocean of Bhakti Ras. Ras means mellow, the juice. It is just like ocean. The ocean has limitation. This ocean has limitation, but the ocean of devotion, which he is describing, has no limitation, it's unlimited. even the ocean of the material, the Atlantic Ocean, the Pacific Ocean, they all have their limitations. But the ocean of devotion, which is being described here by Rupa Goswami, is unlimited. So Rupa Goswami was one of the direct disciples of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. If you read in the Chaitanya Charitamrita, you can read about Lord Chaitanya giving the instructions to Rupa Goswami. It's in the Madhya Lila, chapter 19. One chapter there, the teachings of Lord Chaitanya to Rupa Goswami. And then Chaitanya Charitamrita then goes on, chapter 20, 21, 22, 23, is describing Lord Chaitanya's teachings to Sanatana Goswami. So Rupa and Sanatana, they were two brothers. They were born in high-class Saraswati Brahmana families. But they were recruited by the Nawab Hussein Shah, the Mohammedan ruler, to be ministers in his government. So because they became ministers in the government of the Nawab, they became Muslims, and they had also Muslim names. Rupa Goswami was known as Dabir Khas, and Sanatana Goswami was called Sakaramalik. Kabir Khas and Sakaramalik. So these are Mohammedan names. They were titles actually given to them. But Lord Chaitanya, Lord Chaitanya had manifested in Navadvip and he was performing his pastimes in the Navadvip. He had defeated Keshava Kashmiri, and then there was the Chankasi, and then Lord Chaitanya took sannyas, went off to Jagannath Puri, and converted Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya. So Rupa Goswami and Sanatana Goswami, they were serving the Nawab Hussein Shah, and they were hearing about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and they were attracted. So they wrote letters to Mahaprabhu. Even in 500 years ago, in the times of Lord Chaitanya, there was no email, there was no mobile phone. Yeah, but they were able to somehow write a letter and dispatch it to Jagannath Puri, to the hands of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, on receiving their letters, he wrote back to them and he encouraged them. And Lord Chaitanya also came to meet them. What was the name of the place where they met? Lord Chaitanya came to meet at the residence of Sanatana and Rupa Goswami. They were residing somewhere south of Mount Navadvip, some distance away. They had their residence, not nearby. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came there and he met Rupa and Sanatana. And then later on they met again. After they met Lord Chaitanya, then they were very much inspired to give up that work in the government of the Mohammedan, because they knew the Mohammedan ruler was just a cow killer, and you know, he was doing so many sinful things, very bad association. So they gave up their big positions. And Rupa Goswami left everything and he went to join Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And it is described that when Rupa Goswami retired from his government service, he was a very wealthy man. He had a lot of wealth, so much wealth it filled a boat. And he divided it all in a very exemplary manner. Half of his wealth he gave to the service of the Vaishnavas and the Brahmanas. In other words, for the Krishna conscious people. He gave half of his wealth to them. He gave 25% of his wealth for his family members and relatives, and 25% he kept for himself for emergency purposes. So this is considered very exemplary manner. If some of you are retiring and you have a lot of wealth, so you can do like that. Most of us don't have so much wealth, so we don't have this opportunity. Anyway, you can see Rupa Goswami shown here. This is very renounced, you know. Although he was so wealthy, he gave it all up, and he's wearing a loincloth. You can see the short little piece of cloth which he's wearing, which just goes down to his knees. This is the dress of the Babaji, or the Goswamis in Radhakund and Vrindavan. Even today, they will dress like this. So although Rupa Goswami came from a very high class aristocratic family, and although he had so much wealth, he gave up everything for the service of Lord Krishna under the instructions of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So under the order of Lord Chaitanya, Rupa Goswami wrote this book, the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. Rupa Goswami wrote several other books also. Some of you may have read Nectar of Instruction. It's a much shorter book. Nectar of Instruction is like a summary form of the Nectar of Devotion, condensed form of the Nectar. Nectar of Instruction simply has 11 verses, but it's written by a genius. So when you read these books, we should understand we're associating with a genius. It's not common that we get this opportunity to associate with such a person. So we've described here, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu compared bhakti to a great ocean. When he was speaking before Rupa Goswami, Lord Chaitanya gave him the name Rupa. From Dabir Khas, he made his name Rupa Goswami. And Sanatana Goswami, Sakara Malik, became Sanatana Goswami. And so he said that it is just like an ocean. So I'll take a drop of it and you taste it and you'll understand what is the ocean. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu described a small portion of Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. Bhakti, devotional service. There is a rasa, taste, and the taste is amrita, eternal. So Srila Prabhupada, actually, this is a quotation from Srila Prabhupada. One year, 1971, Srila Prabhupada said he would come to Vrindavan during the month of Kartik, and he would speak on the Nectar of Devotion. And you can hear the recordings and the transcriptions are also there of these lectures which Prabhupada gave in Radha Damodar Temple in the year 1972. Before we had even opened the Krishna Balaram Mandir, Srila Prabhupada came there. The devotees were all thinking, oh, Srila Prabhupada is going to speak about Radha and Krishna. We're going to hear about the most esoteric things, about the loving affairs of the gopis and so on. And Srila Prabhupada came and he spoke on the elements, the basic elements of Bhakti Yoga, as described in this book, The Nectar of Devotion. Okay, so rasa, Srila Prabhupada explains, every service has some attractive feature which drives the servitor progressively on and on. There has to be some taste, some pleasure. Otherwise, how can we do it? The mother has to get some ras from her children. Otherwise, why would she work so hard raising the children, caring for them, cooking for them, cleaning for them, doing so many different services? There's some rasa there. So that force which drives the philanthropist, the householder, and the nationalist is called ras, or a kind of mellow relationship whose taste is very sweet. If it's not sweet, then we won't do it, right? We go away if there's no ras, if we're not enjoying the relationship. Oh, okay, I don't want to be with them anymore. I'm going to change. going to change my job. I'm going to move out. I'm going to go live some other place. Right? So everything depends on the shras. There are some features, however, in our different rasas. Here we've used the term chapala sukha. Chapala sukha, meaning flickering happiness. Flickering happiness. The pleasure doesn't last very long. Just like somebody's working in a job, and they have a job and they're really dedicated to it, they're working very hard. But when the weekend comes, they think, oh, at last, I get out of here, you know. The weekend's here at last. I can relax. You know, they go away to the countryside. They go off to Johor or into Malaysia, go to Malacca or something and enjoy. And then come back to Singapore on Monday or back to work. And so this is chapala sukha. Pleasure. Some pleasure is there. But the pleasure does not last very long. No endurance. And the other term is boga tiaga. Boga is the enjoying part, the sense gratification, and tiaga is the giving up part, the renunciation. So that tendency is there also. One moment we're enjoying, we're having a great time, then the next minute we want to give it all up and go away. Or something happens, you have an argument with someone, you're having a very nice relationship with someone, you're really enjoying their company, and then you have a big disagreement, you clash, all right, I never want to see them again, I'm not going to be with them again, you know? You give them up, you go away, run away from home, not going home again, I'm never coming home again. Right? Tiaga, want to give up. So some people are like that. There's boga, there's tiaga, and there is bhakti. Three kinds of happiness. Some people get happiness from just enjoying the world. That is boga. Tiaga, some people get pleasure from giving up the world. They actually get satisfaction, they feel pleasure from giving up everything. I'm very renounced, I'm free of everything, I have no attachment. Give up the job, right? Give up the job, give up the career, give up everything. I'm very renounced. And we feel, some people feel pleasure from that. But there's another kind of pleasure also, and that comes from bhakti, from service for the Supreme Lord. So three kinds of happiness are there. In rasa, we can see these different phenomena. So amrit, meaning eternal, nectar. Bhakti ras, however, the mellow relish in the transcendental loving service of the Lord does not finish with the end of life. It continues perpetually and is therefore called amrita, that which does not die but exists eternally. Yeah, we are having some pleasure in the material world. We're enjoying, we're very happy in our family. But it's temporary. We're going to die one day. We have to leave. We have to give it all up. We have to understand the temporary nature of the world. But this bhakti ras, that is eternal. That relationship is eternal, never ends. The relationship with Krishna doesn't finish with the body. One couple came to Srila Prabhupada, it was John Lennon and Yoko Ono in England, when Prabhupada was staying at their home. They both came to Prabhupada and they said, Swami, they could understand Prabhupada was very powerful. And they begged Srila Prabhupada, please bless us that we will be husband and wife in our next life also. Well, they could understand at least they're going to die. At least they had that understanding. And they were asking Prabhupada, please bless us that next life we will again be husband and wife. And Prabhupada told them, no, I will not give that blessing. I cannot give that blessing. This is nonsense. He said, you come together, you will be separated. So, any action performed for the satisfaction of Krishna in this transcendental bhakti ras stay in this bhakti ras stage of life can be relished perpetually. When one is thus engaged in devotional service, all varieties of ras are mellow, turned into eternity. Here are the Goswamis, and they give Srinivasacharya has given us the Goswami Astika. Actually, this verse is stated in the beginning of the book Nectar of Devotion. If you look, if you have a copy of Nectar of Devotion, if you open the book, you'll see the very beginning, you'll see this verse. And this verse is like presented because it's, the book is like dedicated to the Goswamis. And the translation of this verse describes the activities of the Goswamis, particularly the fact that they're studying the scriptures, nana shastra vicharinai kanipano sadharma samstapako. They studied all the Vedic scriptures to establish the religious principles. Srila Prabhupada said, we don't have to do any more research. The research has already been done for us by the Goswamis. They've studied all the scriptures for us. And they have given us the most important parts of the scriptures in their writings. So this verse particularly highlights that fact. If you see on your sheet, you'll see there's a translation of that verse. Srinivasacharya says, I offer my respectful obeisances to the six Goswamis who are engaged in scrutinizingly studying all the revealed scriptures with the aim of establishing eternal religious principles for the benefit of all human beings. Thus they are honored all over the three worlds, and they are worth taking shelter of because they are absorbed in the mood of the gopis and engaged in the transcendental loving service of Radha and So in this way, Srinivasacharya describes something of the activities of the Goswamis, and particularly Rupa Goswami, shown here in this book, Nectar of Devotion, that he has compiled it with so many references, so many quotations from different scriptures, all from the Vedic writings. Why did he do all this? For our benefit. Not only our benefit, for the benefit of all living beings. So the six Goswamis, they wrote so many books just to establish what is real religion. What does he say? Nana shastra vicharinai kanimbano sadharma samstapako. Why? Lokanam hitakarino. They were simply doing welfare activities for the people in general. Lokanam. So, right? Brahmanda Brahmite Kunya Bhagavanji Guru Krishna Prasadi Pai Bhakti Lato. No, I'm thinking of something, sorry. It should be Bharata Bhumite Haila Manushya Janmaja Janma Sataka Karekara Para Upaka. Right? Para upaka, for others' benefit. So the instruction was given by Lord Chaitanya that people born in Bharatvarsa are very fortunate to have the human life. They should take advantage of the human life to become Krishna conscious. And then they should make others also Krishna conscious. They should work for the benefit of others. We do not cultivate Krishna consciousness simply for our own benefit, but we want to give it. And we see this in the example of the Goswamis, that their writings, why were they writing? They were not getting any money from it, you know. They weren't going to get an income from it. People often write, they get some, maybe the publishers give them some money or something. But you know, the Goswamis were not thinking like that. They were simply writing on palm leaves, When you go to Vrindavan, if you go to the Vrindavan Research Institute, in Vrindavan Research Institute, they still have some of the original palm leaves which the Goswamis wrote on. Some of the original writings of Rupa Goswami is there. They preserved it. They wrote on palm leaves. They didn't have any computer. They didn't even have a big pen. They didn't have any nice paper. They simply wrote on palm leaves. 500 years ago, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's time, there were no books. There was no printing presses. Everything was handwritten. You wanted a copy of Srimad Bhagavatam? Somebody has to write it. But you know, the Goswamis, they accepted all of this. Somehow they studied all of the Vedic scriptures, so many books. They studied all of these and then they compiled these books like the Nectar of Devotion to give us the essence of all the Vedic teachings. So this is their great kindness on us that they performed. Formerly, the society was not so much degraded. As soon as you give evidence from the Vedic literature, they would accept. So these Goswamis were making research from the Vedic literature. Samaveda, Rig Veda, Upanishads, Vedanta Sutra, Puranas, Mahabharata, Srimad Bhagavatam, you find Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu evidence. As I said, his writing is full of quotations from all of these different books. Srila Rupa Goswami, the author, Srila Rupa Goswami is described in the Bhakti Ratnakar as the one who knows the essence of devotional service. His famous book, Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, is the science of devotional service. By reading this book, one can understand the meaning of devotional service. Why did Srila Prabhupada write this book for us? He wants us to understand the meaning of devotional service. In the Gaura Gunadeshtipika, Srila Rupa Goswami is described to be the gopi named Sri Rupa Manjari, Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. It's the most celebrated book by Rupa Goswami. So the identity of Rupa Goswami in the spiritual world is mentioned here. Rupa Manjari. The Manjaris are the confidential assistants of Radha and Krishna. So Rupa Goswami, we can understand, he's a very intimate associate of Radha and Krishna. And he came in the pastimes of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to write these books so that we could have the benefit of all of his research, all of his knowledge. Can you read it for me? Somebody can read this for me? Sri Chaitanya Manobhistam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Srila Rupa Goswami. We offer our respects to Rupa Goswami like this in our pranam mantra, right? When will Srila Rupa Goswami, who has established within this world the mission to fulfill the desire of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, give me shelter at his lotus feet. So like this, we offer our prayers to Rupa Goswami. We try to understand how important is the position of Rupa Goswami. There are many people worship Krishna, but not everyone worships Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Only some people also worship Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and by Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's guidance and instruction, we can know how to understand Radha and Krishna. But there are many people who worship Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and not all of them recognize the importance of Srila Rupa Goswami. Srila Rupa Goswami's position is very important. And without knowing Rupa Goswami, then we cannot actually understand fully Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And without that connection, then we can never know Radha and Krishna. So Rupa Goswami's position is very important in this connection. That it's by the mercy of Rupa Goswami that we can understand properly the mission of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. When we have a lot of time, we ask devotees, identify reasons for Prabhupada writing the Nectar of Devotion. Prabhupada said, I have written this book for the devotees. Not only this book, of course, actually all of Prabhupada's books were written for the devotees. But particularly this book, Nectar of Devotion, was Prabhupada described it as being the handbook for the Krishna consciousness movement. Just like if you work in the, you know, Indian railways, they have a handbook. If you work for Microsoft, you know, they have a handbook, you know. Wherever you, you know, big companies, big corporations, they will have their handbook. So, Nectar of Devotion is a handbook for the Krishna consciousness movement. Another point is, when Srila Prabhupada took initiation, it was in the year 1933, Srila Prabhupada was initiated by Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati. And when he was initiated, at that time, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Prabhupada told him, you should study the book Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. He had been ordered, he had been instructed by his spiritual master that you should study this book. It is very important and it will help you greatly to understand devotional service, to understand why we're practicing Krishna consciousness. It will allow us also to know Krishna in the different rasas, the different mellows, the different dealings which Lord Krishna has with his devotees. It's a very important book for all of us. But I know last time I gave this class in Singapore, many people said, oh, I've never read this book, or I've never read this book, you know. We tend to overlook it. Actually, there are some temples, I know, for example, in Hyderabad, in Abbots, every morning they will read from the Nectar of Devotion. After Mangal Aarti, for 5 minutes, they will read a few lines from the Nectar of Devotion. It's very important for us. We need to read all of Prabhupada's books, just like we study Srimad Bhagavatam in the morning, in the evening we would have Bhagavad Gita class, in the middle of the day you can be reading Ishopanishad, or Nectar of Instruction, Nectar of Devotion. It can also be studied like that. We need to hear. Prabhupada wrote these books for all of us. Reasons why, discuss how these reasons are relevant for you individually and society at large. Individually, it will help us to become Krishna conscious, to remember Krishna. And for society at large, it will help them to understand the goal of life, help them to get out of their ignorance. Okay, we don't have time to do all of this. Originally in Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, the ocean is divided. We're explaining about the structure of the book, Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, how he wrote it. And so he described the book as being a Sindhu, like an ocean. So within the ocean, there's the north, the south, the east, the west. In the same way, there's different parts of the book. There's the northern, the southern, the eastern, the western. They're all shown here in the diagram. Here you can see the first part is there, the Purva Vibhaga, first 19 chapters based on Bhagavad Bhakti Veda, describing the basic principles of devotion. And then going on, there's this second part, Dakshina Bhakti Bhaga, Samanya Bhagavad Bhakti Rasa. And then you've got Dupya Bhakti Ras, and on the top, Gora Bhakti Ras. So these different stages, these are the four different sections of the ocean. In the first part, there are four waves. The first being a general description of devotional service. The second concerns the regulated principles by executing devotional service. And the third wave, devotional service in ecstasy. And the fourth is the ultimate goal, love of God. And so these are the different stages of devotional service as described, Prabhupada describes for us in the introduction, shown here. So this first section, the first 19 chapters, describe the varieties of devotional service. And it begins with what we're covering this evening, the introduction, and then goes on to describe sadhana bhakti. Chapter 2 to chapter 10, describing sadhana bhakti. Sadhana bhakti meaning devotional service in practice. And then bhava bhakti, chapter 17 and 18. Bhava bhakti meaning devotional service in ecstasy. And then prema bhakti in chapter 19. Prema bhakti meaning devotional service in love of God. So you can see the three different levels of devotional service. Sadhana, bhavana, bhava, and prema. Devotional service in practice, devotional service in ecstasy, and devotional service in love of God. They're all described one after another. The emphasis, of course, on sadhana bhakti, chapter 2 to chapter 16. So, major portion. We want to hear about devotional service in practice. Srila Prabhupada then begins in the introduction. He has his Mangala Charana. When you're writing, it is customary to begin by offering prayers and seeking the blessings of different people. Just like in Srimad Bhagavatam, the first three verses of the first chapter, of the first canto, are the Mangala Charana of the Srimad Bhagavatam. So similarly, in Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, Srila Prabhupada has translated the Mangala Charana, invoking auspiciousness, and the objective of the book. This is all the purposes of the Mangala Charana. So Lord Sri Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the cause of all causes, the reservoir of all rasas or relationships. Rupa Goswami had composed a verse like this. Actually, the verse is also given there in Chaitanya Charitamrita. I think Rupa Goswami composed the verse first. Then later on, the verse was used by Krishnadas Kaviraj in the Chaitanya Charitamrita. But the verse describes Lord Krishna, the position of Lord Krishna, that he's the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the cause of all causes. Well, we have heard this also in Brahma Samhita, Sarva Karana Karanam, the cause of all causes. But we hear also that he's the reservoir of all rasas. Now, sometimes people want to know why Krishna is the Supreme and why not Vishnu, why not Lord Rama. But we see that it's Krishna who's the reservoir of all rasas. We don't see all these rasas manifest in the presence of Lord Vishnu or in Lord Rama. But we see the full display of ras in the dealings of Lord Krishna. So that is why Lord Krishna is accepted as being the supreme. The objective of the book, Akila Rasamrita Murti, all embodiment of all different ras, the form of all different rasas. This is Lord Krishna. So from Nectar of Devotion, we can understand more of how Krishna is the reservoir of all rasa. And of course that is actually in Krishna in Vrindavan. In Chaitanya Charitamrita it is described, Lord Krishna is perfect in Dwarka. He is more perfect in Mathura, but he is most perfect in Vrindavan. And so it's Vrindavan Krishna, who is the reservoir of all rasa. And this will be described to us in detail within the pages of the Nectar of Devotion. So we may enjoy Krishna's loving service in so many ways, not only by the embrace of the gopis, but in the fight with Bhishma, but in the fight of Bhishma with Krishna, piercing his body with arrows. Therefore, Krishna is Akila Ras Amrita. So Krishna is enjoying the gopis, the embraces of the gopis, and he enjoys also Bhishma firing arrows into his body. It's described that the arrows piercing the body of Krishna were considered, it was like the loving bites which are exchanged between a man and woman. And so the arrows, when they pierced that body of Krishna, it brought transcendental pleasure to him. This is Rasamrita. There are 12 rasas, either primary rasa or secondary rasa. Any rasa, Krishna is ready to respond to any ras you want to deal with Krishna. So 5 primary rasas, 7 secondary rasas. All of these different rasas are displayed in the pastimes of Krishna. Okay, so we'll just see what we've been speaking about this evening, just to summarize. In the preface, we explained the meaning of the term Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. We were explaining how it's an ocean of the nectar of loving mellows of devotion. And we discussed our expectation, our experience of relishing eternal rasa in Krishna consciousness. In the material world, you know, we have some rasa, but after some time we become tired. You know, you're doing something, in the beginning we find some pleasure, but after some time then we get tired of it. Oh, I want a change, or I'm getting tired, I need a change, I need some... But in Krishna consciousness, the pleasure is always increasing. If we're actually in Krishna consciousness, we don't feel tired. We have the example of the Goswamis, that they conquered over eating and sleeping. They were so advanced, so elevated. Prabhupada said also, he said, when I was a young man, I gave up mating and defending. And then he said, now in my old age, I have conquered over eating and sleeping. I have given up, not just conquered, he said, I have given up eating and sleeping. So, this is the nature of bhakti ras. When we're experiencing actually real devotion, we don't feel tired. Many of you have experienced during Rath Yatra or Janmashtami, you're doing a lot of service, you're doing so much work, you sleep less, you forget all about you're up all night doing things, helping to prepare. You forget everything, you forget about eating, you forget about sleeping. That is the nature of bhakti ras. Sometimes I remember in the Western countries we would have Christmas marathon. And for 1 month we would go on book distribution every day from morning till night. We would be out distributing books. And in fact, usually every year, even now, many places, many temples and devotees will do this. They will go out the whole day, all day, distributing books. I know even there's, you know that one girl from Singapore, Swan Mataji? She will take time off her work to go on the Christmas marathon. She's such a dedicated book distributor. She will take leave from her work, she'll take her vacation at that time so that she can go on the Christmas marathon and distribute books. Very nice, very nice. Many devotees have that mood, they have that experience, they're experiencing bhakti ras. And when you have that bhakti ras, you don't worry anymore, you forget about the body, you transcend all the miseries of the body. The more we're conscious of the body, the more we're in ignorance. So this is eternal rasa. And then we spoke also about the significance of Rupa Goswami. We said that devotional service has to be understood, being guided by people like Rupa Goswami. Very important. But that's why we're reading this book, Nectar of Devotion. We want to read also Nectar of Instruction. These are very important books for us. We're so fortunate that Srila Prabhupada translated these books and presented them for us. We have to take advantage. Identify Prabhupada's purpose in writing these books, discuss their relevance. Prabhupada wants us to know about devotional service in different levels, in different rasas. And he wants us also to distribute this. So all of this is explained in the preface. In the introduction, it begins to explain the objective of Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu with reference to Vrindavan Krishna. It is in Vrindavan that Krishna's rasa is fully manifested. Most perfect. We often cannot appreciate so much that, but it is Vrindavan which is the supreme abode. There was some discussion in Chaitanya Charitamrita. Srivas Pandit was commenting, oh, look at the opulence of the goddess of fortune. You know, the goddess of fortune comes with her servants and they arrest the servants of Jagannath. There's a pastime which takes place during the Rath Yatra festival. So Srivas Pandit, he's Narada Muni. Narada Muni is a Vaikuntha man. And so when he saw the goddess of fortune, he was appreciating, oh, look at the opulence of Mother Lakshmi, the goddess of fortune, oh, so great. But Swarup Damodar Goswami was there, and Swarup Damodar said to him, he said, you don't know the opulence of Vrindavan. He said, Vrindavan, every tree is a kalpa vriksha. Every cow is a surabhi cow. Every grain of dust, every speck of dust in the dham is Chintamani. This is the opulence of Vrindavan. When we go to Vrindavan, we don't have that kind of vision often. We forget. We see something else. So Vrindavan Krishna is Akila Rasamrita Sindhu. Here's a quotation of Srila Prabhupada. Our philosophy is not to mix up with the water superficially, but enter into the water and live like fish, big, big fish. Prabhupada is explaining this because people often think the goal of life is to merge. They think we have to merge, we have to become one with the Supreme. And they think becoming one means merging. You know, you go to these other yoga societies, you'll see everywhere impersonalism. And they're speaking about merging. And they give the example, as the rivers flow into the ocean and become one with the sea, we have to also enter into the ocean and become one. But Prabhupada said, no, it's not like that at all. It's not like that. He said, we're not like a drop of water flowing into the ocean. The drops may flow into the ocean, But that water in the ocean will be evaporated. It will be carried in the form of clouds and then come back on the land again. You don't want that. We want to stay in the ocean. You go into the ocean, you stay in the ocean. And Prabhupada says, the big fish, the big aquatics, they go deep into the ocean. They have nothing to do with these rivers of liberation. So Prabhupada said, it's not like drops of water. He said, and so he's mentioning here, this philosophy is not to mix up with the water, but enter into the water and live there like fish, big, big fish. But if you remain superficially on the water, then you will be evaporated and again thrown outside, come as a river. Your coming and going, repetition of birth and death, will not stop. So once you become a big fish, then there is no evaporation. So don't be misled by this Mayavadi philosophy that you fall into. Very nice, very important point, because people often speak about this merging. You think you have to become one. Prabhupada said, how is it possible to become one? We're all individuals. She has her nature, he has his nature. How can we all become one? Prabhupada was in Australia one time. The people came from, I think it was Maharishi. They had a vegetarian restaurant there in Australia. And they came to meet Prabhupada. They were running a vegetarian restaurant. And they were talking about merging. And Prabhupada said, well, how is it possible? Do you ever see any merging? Can you merge with anybody? Have you ever merged with anybody? It's impossible. It's not practical. How can you merge? How can you become one? You're all individuals. And then Prabhupada gave the example. He said, just like fingers. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We have 5 fingers. How do they become one? You use them in the hand. As a hand, you can take something, you can pick it up, you can hold it in the finger. They have the same interest. It's not that one finger is doing something, the other finger is doing something else. All 5 fingers are working together. They have the common interest. When the center is there, then there is oneness. But if he has his center and she has her center and I have my center, then there's conflict. Then there's no one. But when we all have the common interest, the common center, then there is real possibility of oneness. So we want to merge the interests, have the same interests. So this is the point. In this way, Srila Prabhupada was defeating the Mayavadi philosophy. Okay, so any question? Yes, Prabhu?
You were talking about Mayavadi philosophy, right? The idea of merging, that is what Srila Prabhupada debunks. I was interested to know, I mean, what Buddhism preaches. Is it the kind of Mayavadi philosophy that you're talking about, like merging with everyone's?
Generally, the Buddhists preach about voidism, nothingness. Yeah. That you are not real, and I am not real, and this world is not real, and nothing is real. Right? That's what they teach. They do not talk about God, they talk about nothing. Nothingness. The void. Nepa, or Nirvana. The nothingness.
So in that way, they are denying the existence of God in himself.
Yes, Buddhism is an atheistic religion. There's no God. There is no God. They don't believe in God. They don't even believe in the soul. They do talk about the soul, but they talk about the soul in a material sense. They say the soul can be annihilated. The soul can be destroyed. And they say this body can also be destroyed. generally, if you go to a Buddhist temple, you will see what they often do. They keep a dead body, and they sit and they meditate on that dead body. Or sometimes, you know, every Buddhist temple, they have a crematorium. They have they have a place where they burn the bodies. And sometimes the monks, they'll go, when they're not burning bodies, when the furnace is turned off, they will go and sit in that furnace and they meditate that ultimately this is the destiny, this is the end of life. That we're nothing, we don't really exist. And, this is their meditation. They meditate on death, on being nothing, coming to nothingness. Mayavadis, they're talking about the oneness. Their oneness is that light, you know, the impersonal, unmanifested, which is also a temporary, that's also another atheistic philosophy. Mayavadi philosophy is also atheism, because they're saying everyone is God, or we're all God. So if everyone is God, there's no meaning to God anymore. So it's atheism. If you're God and I'm God and we're all God, then, you know, what does it mean to be? It doesn't have any meaning anymore. It's simply atheism. So both Buddhism and Mayavadi, this is Prabhupada's mission. Gauravani Pricharini Nirvisesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarini. Srila Prabhupada was preaching the message of Lord Chaitanya to defeat these two philosophies, because they're so prominent, they're spread everywhere. Impersonalism and voidism, nirvishesha and shunyavad. Everything is shunya, that's Buddhist philosophy, shunya, void, nothing. Any other question? How do you get the inspiration?
Yeah.
So anyway, that's why I'm giving the class. I'm trying to inspire you. Right? I try to inspire you. I want to encourage you to try to read it a little bit. At least you come in here, you know, the class, you begin to know something a little bit about what's in the book. And eventually one day you want to read it yourself. Idea. By hearing, then we get interested. So I'm trying to fan that spark, you know, some little spark, you fan it and make it into the fire. Mm-hmm. Okay, so then we will stop here. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Shri Prabhupada.